Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. We've got a great show for you tonight with Sally Quinn. Sally Quinn got her start in the style section of the Washington Post. She got Henry Kissinger to say, "I'm a secret swinger." She went on to becoming the co-host of the CBS Morning News. She's written for Washington Post Outlook. She's had a distinguished journalistic career. She now has become a blogger, and a blogger on a blog called On Faith. What in goodness sakes is Sally Quinn doing with a religious blog, and does a religious blog make any difference? That's what we want to ask her tonight. Sally, welcome.
Did you like that? Glad to be here.
Did you like
that? You should see the expression on your face when you said a religious blog.
I want to know. I mean,
you mean how did I get here from there?
Yeah. In 2 seconds.
You know, it's not, when you think about it, it's not that unusual, because what I did all my life for the Washington Post was write about people in Washington, do profiles, what makes them tick. And certainly after 9/11, it seemed to me that people were sort of going N-word, questioning, yearning, searching. It just, the atmosphere was different. And I decided that I wanted to see what it was that made people in Washington react and form their values and their morals and do the things that they do, make the decisions they do. And it seemed to me that a lot of times it was based on their faith. And so for me, it was just the next step. What is it, how people, what they believe, what their beliefs are. And it's always about religion or spirituality or not. And so that's how I got into this. And then we have one on foreign policy called
We,
the Washington Post, had a feature called Post Global, which was about foreign policy, where you pose a question once a week to foreign policy analysts around the world. So I thought it would be interesting to do the same thing with religion. But I couldn't do it on my own. I went to lunch with Don Graham, and I proposed this, and he said, "I want you to do it." And I said, "But I don't know anything about the internet, and I don't know anything about religion." He said, "You do it." So I enlisted John Meacham, who is the new editor of Newsweek, and who is a religion scholar and a completely brilliant person. And so John and I are the co-moderators. Without John, I am nothing. I mean, he's the main man here. He's the one who really knows what the topic is. And so we posed a question. What we did was we got the most extraordinary group of panelists, religion scholars, theologians, thinkers, philosophers. We've got Catholics and Protestants and Jews and Hindus and Buddhists and atheists. I mean, we've got everybody. And we have the most extraordinary discussions every week. It's really wonderful.
You know, I'm sort of surprised to hear, as a journalist, we want to figure out whether, as a blogger, you still are a journalist. Wait till we come to the end to ask you that. But as a journalist, thinking about how people tick, react, so forth and so on, you were able to get, or you thought you were able to get, people to talk about their religion, because the custom, at least for Protestants and WASPs, and I would have thought perhaps a lot of other people except maybe conservative Christians, you don't talk about religion. So if you're a reporter and people don't talk about religion, it's a pretty hard story to get, isn't it? Have you been able to get people to talk about religion? I mean, just generally speaking, the blog's a little different because it's voluntary. But
this is a really good question, because I think in all the years that I interviewed people in Washington, I can't remember ever asking anyone about their religion, except maybe Bob Novak, who converted from Judaism to Catholicism. And he was married to a Southern Baptist, and he said it was okay with her mother when she married a Jew, but her mother went crazy when he turned into a Catholic. I mean, that may be one of the only religious conversations I've had with anybody. But I've found that since I started working on this, which has been about a year ago. I actually decided to write a book first, and then this website came up afterward. But I can't get anybody to stop talking about it. I mean, the minute people know what I'm doing, they get me off in a corner and they want to talk about it.
I did a piece
about 6 or 7 years ago on religion in Washington, and essentially it was what you're just saying, that no one ever talks about religion in Washington. As Susan Mary, also one of the great Washington hostesses, said at the time, darling, it is just simply not done. One does not talk about one's religion. But so there was this really interesting sort of separation between a church and church in Washington, where socially no one ever discussed it. Then the politicians would go out campaigning, and on the hustings they would talk about God because they had to in order to get elected. And then they would come back, and it would sort of be, everyone would be turning a blind eye to that. Well, that's just something you have to do out there, but you certainly don't want to deal with it here.
Do you think
and
this
it's
is
very different now.
Now, John Kerry gave a great speech in Washington at some point before his campaign, to which people were always referring, this man can really talk about his religion. But when he campaigned, he clammed up as though he didn't even want to talk about it publicly. Do you think that was a huge mistake for Kerry?
Well, I think that for particularly for Easterners and Northeasterners, it is always a subject that has been very private, and you saw that with the Bush seniors. I mean, they were Episcopalians from Connecticut, and they never talked about their faith, ever. And so that was stunning when George Bush W. came in and was so much out there as a born-again Christian, so different from the parents. I think that John Kerry and Howard Dean both were in a jam because though they may be religious personally, it is one of those things that culturally in the Northeast you don't talk openly about your religion. It's a cultural issue. Whereas in the South, you know, you're always saying God bless you and Jesus, you know, loves you and all of that kind of thing, and it's very much a part of the language and a part of the culture to talk about it. And I think that when they went outside of the area that they were comfortable in, it just, you could see that they would cringe every time they try to mention God because it wasn't a natural thing for them to do. And what it came across as is inauthentic, as though they were pandering.
We must be authentic. What's Obama, do you know?
I think Obama is a genuine Christian. And I think that this, the interesting thing about him and this speech that he made this summer was that he really came across as someone who is very comfortable with his faith and with an authentic about it, but does not appear to be pandering. It's matter of fact.
And how about Hillary? Do you think Hillary's pandering about her religion? I don't even know what religion is Hillary?
I think she's a Methodist. Well, I think that, you know, she's from Illinois. Her Bill was from Arkansas, where religion is much more openly discussed. And I think that when she came in, you know, they had campaigned in the South, and they had won in the South. Remember that Michael Kelly cover story on the New York Times Magazine, St. Hillary, where I think he criticized her for using her religion in a way that he felt was not authentic. And I think that she's a little bit in a jam now because she is a Northeasterner now. She's lived in Washington for 8 years. She's been senator in New York for 6 years. Again, the whole idea of religion and the culture is not one where you speak out. And yet, in order to win, she's going to have to go campaigning in the South. Most of the press is secular Northeastern. And the minute that she's out in the South talking about religion, they get a whiff of pandering, they're going to go after her.
Do you think maybe you're now getting behind the curve on religion for this reason? In the last presidential election, the number one item that came up on the poll, 23% or 24%, was religious values drove my vote. But that was the presidential election. Then in the congressional election, it turned out that the evangelical Christians, who probably answered that question at a rate at least of 23%, they split. And the evangelical Christians went over to the Democrats, which leads one to believe maybe the whole idea was a fad, this religious thing was a fad, and that maybe you were back there at the time of the presidential election. Now we're going to go in a different direction.
No, I don't think that's true.
You think it's an upswing?
No, I think that what's happening is what I've just been talking about, is the idea of authenticity. I think that they believed George Bush. They believed he was evangelical. They believed he was born again. But I think they were very disappointed in what happened in this administration, that he didn't fight for the things that they care about, like abortion and stem cell research and that sort of thing. Also, the evangelicals, by the way, have become very much involved in the environment. You know, this is God's earth, God's creation, and we're not protecting it. And I think they were very upset with the Bush administration for not concentrating on the environment. So I think there was that issue. And then don't forget, right before the election, the book came out by the man who ran the faith-based office at the White House, who said, oh, we just used them, and we were mocking them all the time and making fun of them, and, you know, we just were basically trying to get their pandering for their votes. So I think that the evangelicals just decided, wait a minute, you know, we're not going to be used. And also, I think a lot of them are against the war. And so I think that had a huge effect on them. But I think that it not only is it not a fad, I think it is growing. I think people are much more aware of religion. You have to be today, Jamie. I mean, you look at what happens in the domestic policy. You see how religion affects everything that goes on. Practically every decision that's made in the White House today is about religion. You look at foreign policy, you know, you look at the Middle East and Palestine and Israel, you look at Iran, Syria, the Muslims, the Jews, you look at the Pope, who scheduled a trip.
But he's religious, I would agree with that.
Well, no, but he's he scheduled a trip to Turkey, essentially to sort of tighten the bonds between the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church. And what does he end up doing? He ends up recommending that Turkey be a member of the European Union. And that's a huge foreign policy story. So that, I mean, you can't even separate out religion from what's going on in the world today. So you have to, at least if you're not a believer, and certainly plenty of people are not, but you really need to understand it. I noticed that Harvard now is requiring students to take a course in religion, and I think that's really good. I think high schools should require a course in religion, and religion, the history of religion.
Sally Quinn, are you a believer, a true believer?
Well, I was an atheist for most of my life.
Was,
yes. And I started having, actually, one of the reasons John Meacham, the editor of Newsweek and my co-moderator, got together on this is because I'd started having lunch with John several years ago, and we talked about religion. I remember telling him I was an atheist, and he said, "You are not." And I said, "Yes, I am. Are not. Am too." Are, you know. And he finally convinced me that the word atheist was not a good word.
So what's the word for now?
Well, he said you don't want to define yourself negatively. And he was right, because an atheist is someone who denies the existence of God. Well, how do I know? You know, maybe there is a God, maybe there isn't. But I also came after doing a lot of studying and reading and learning now how much I don't know about religion, that I came to respect religion, which I did not before.
Let me read what one of the bloggers said about Sally Quinn. Sally Quinn seems to be the last person that should be moderating something called On Faith, that's the name of your blog, since it is readily apparent she has none. let's talk about becoming a blogger and your blog. And let's
Wait, can I just answer that question?
Oh yes,
right.
Of course, yeah.
I think that, as I said, I now, there was a Broadway play called How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying. And Robert Morris, at one point, sings the song, Into the Mirror, and he says, "You have the cool, clear eyes of a seeker of wisdom and truth." And I would say that that probably defines what I am right now, a seeker of wisdom and truth. Somebody who is learning and studying, and I think I'm probably the best person to have a religious blog because I am respectful of all religions.
And you don't have, and you don't have a necessary point of view, which some of your what do I call them? What's a co-panelist?
Well,
what's a co-blogger?
Well, the panelists. The panelists are all over.
You're
the
not
place.
A panelist. Well, but your panelists obviously have a point.
Oh, they're
of view.
All. They all do, and they're all over the place. John Meacham is a practicing Christian. But John is very much of the sort of view that people should believe what they want to believe. Very much what he wrote a book about the founding fathers called American Gospel, which was a big bestseller. in which he talked about how the founding fathers basically were deists and said people should be able to, this country is not founded on religion. We left England because to get away from persecution, religious persecution, and that people should be able to believe what they want.
Let's put up on the camera the blog, which is called On Faith. I think the easiest way to get it is the way I got it, which is that I went to Google, and I said, Sally Quinn dash blog, boom, boom, I was right
Did
there.
Did you really? Yeah. Oh, that's interesting.
That's the easiest way to get to it. But there's another way of getting, you go to Newsweek and blah, 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 blah. But
well,
anyway, do it my way, audience.
You can go to WashingtonPost.com or Newsweek.com and right. Hit on faith.
Okay, so now, this is the digital age. You now become a member of the digital age in doing this blog. And I'm interested in finding out how blogs are put together. And how this one particularly is put together now. The audience, if you go to On Faith, you'll find a question. The one I like the best is a question, I want to discuss it in a minute, was, is Thanksgiving a religious holiday? You've got a couple in the works you told me about before we went on the show.
Right. Well, the one we have up this week that's actually changing will be what do you tell your children about God?
Yeah.
And then we have one, is this a Christian nation?
Is it a Christian nation?
And should it be? And then we've got one is Jesus Christ the Son of God?
Right.
If he isn't, who is he? And if he is the Son of God, what exactly does that mean?
The provocative questions. One I've got in front of me here says, millions of people are in mixed faith marriages, .. How would you advise them to describe God to their children over the holiday season? I mean, those are great questions. Who thinks of the questions?
Well, John and I do.
Really? How do you do it? Is it every day?
Well,
I mean,
a light bulb just comes off in my head. a lot of times people will come up and say, they'll ask me questions about things that are concerning them. Probably most of my friends are in mixed faith marriages, and so I know that it's a big issue, particularly around Christmas time. What do you tell them, and how do you tell them? And so John and I actually both wrote a little piece about it. He talked about what he's telling his 2-year-old and 4-year-old about God. And I had always told Quinn, my son, now 24, that I was an atheist, but I wanted him to be exposed to other religions, so I sent him to my parents every week, and they would read him Bible stories, and I taught him about other religions. But I didn't want to lie to him. I didn't want to tell him that I believed something that I didn't. But I didn't know what he believed, and I sat down to interview him before I wrote this piece, and I found out that he believed in God.
And you didn't know until you interviewed him?
No. I didn't know. And I didn't know Quinn was seriously learning disabled and was very sick most of his life and had open heart surgery. And he said, I think that God gave me these problems because I think he knew that I could handle them, that I was strong enough.
But the way the questions are done, some of them to me sound like Sally Quinn questions because they're journalistic questions that pry open the religion can, so to speak. Others sound more formal, and I have read some of John Meacham's stuff. He is the editor of Newsweek. He's no fooling around type of journalist. He's written real books on religion. But it seems to me that your contribution must be that you've got the working, not that John Meacham isn't a working journalist, the working journalist angle, and you're probably driving some of these questions. How often do you put a question up?
Once a week.
Oh, it goes up once a week.
Once a week, yeah.
And so then, do you go back and forth on email with John as to?
Oh, yeah. And then Lisa Miller, who's the religion editor of Newsweek, who's fantastic, and she actually has a cover story out this week on how Jesus, Mary, and Joseph were the perfect Jewish family and represented Jewish family values.
I don't know why I'm laughing.
It's a great piece and really interesting.
I tend to laugh about religion. I
shouldn't. Carol Murphy, who's our producer and was the religion reporter at the Post. I mean, we all sort of get together. But John and I are a really interesting combination because John is a total intellectual and a religion scholar and a history scholar. I am none of those things. I come at it from a much more personal point of view. And so I think the combination is really good because we're very different, except that we do have the same point of view on religion, which is that everyone should believe what they want to believe.
Okay, let's go back to how these blogs work. So you put up the question once a week, and then the bloggers come in. Can the bloggers answer your question forever? I mean, is that question up forever?
That question is up for the week, and then they can answer that question for the week.
Only can answer it for a week.
For the week.
And then it disappears?
Well, no, then it goes down into the archives.
Archives, but you can't answer that question.
Do you know, that's a good question, Jamie. I don't know the answer to that, and I should, but we've only been up for a couple of weeks, and so there's a lot of the stuff that I'm not absolutely sure about, and we're changing things, too. We're going to have a capacity in the next week to have the panelists interact with each other in real time.
I wanted to ask about that. You're not a panelist. Do you go to the blog and read it every day?
I do, yeah. I mean, I don't have to, I mean, you know, the 137 comments, I don't have time to read all the comments on all of the answers from the panelists, but I glance at them just to get a general tone and see how people are responding to what we're doing and what the reaction is.
What if you do, if someone posts an entry like this, Sally, run, don't walk to the nearest bookstore and purchase the God Delusion. Trust me, if you have any brains, you won't become any closer to believe in a supernatural being than you are now. It will save you from being stupid.
Yes,
when that's posted, what do you go on and answer that?
Well, that was actually on a live chat that I did.
You did a live chat?
Yeah, yesterday. I do an online chat.
Oh, you do chats too?
Most weeks. Yeah, just to answer questions that people have of me about the question of the week. And yes, I actually have read Richard Dawkins' book, The God Delusion. It's very interesting. And I think that everyone should read it because I think it's really important. The same way I think everyone should read the Bible and the Quran, and everyone should study all religions. I think that the atheists have very good arguments. And Dawkins said that he thinks that atheism is where homosexuality was 20 years ago in terms of being coming out of the closet.
Coming out of the closet?
Yeah, and that now.
Really?
Yes, and that atheists are now able to come out of the closet and say they are atheists in a way and be accepted in a way they never could before. But they're way behind. I mean, they are definitely in the minority. But it's interesting that people. We have four atheists on the panel. And they're professional. One of them is Daniel Dennett, who is a philosophy professor at Tufts.
You're agnostic, excuse me, Peter.
No, I'm not agnostic.
You're not atheist, mm-hmm. You're not agnostic.
We
don't know any more about you than when we started.
Yeah, I told you I was a seeker of wisdom and truth.
Seeker of wisdom and truth, yeah.
No, we're all agnostics, Jamie. I mean, nobody really knows. I mean, people who think they know are people who have faith, and that's great if they believe that. But in the end, I can't stand up and say this is true or this is not true.
Let me ask you, there was an interesting question that I referred to at the beginning of the show. Is Thanksgiving a religious holiday? And one of your panelists said, when they say religion, when they say thank you, as in Thanksgiving, they are being religious. And then another panelist said, it is an opportunity to thank God. Thanksgiving implies a giver. Those two answers saying, Thanksgiving is a religious holiday. Is it a religious holiday, Sally Quinn?
Well, I think it's a religious holiday to some people and not to others. I think to some people it's they are giving thanks to God. Some people are giving thanks to the Indians who saved the settlers and brought them food when they were starving. In my family, I give thanks. I said grace this year for the first time.
Did you know how to say
it? In honor of my father,
yeah.
Yes. Well, my father used to say, and I refused to say grace because I was a non-believer, and he used to say, Lord, make us truly thankful for these blessings which we are about to receive in Christ's name. Amen. And I refused to say it, and I wouldn't bow my head or anything. And finally, the year before my mother had a stroke and our family sort of fell apart, I let my father say grace at my house, which I was really grateful
but
for much later.
Excuse me interrupting, but Thanksgiving can't be a religious holiday.
Well, but a lot of people
feel
that it's...
Everything is religious.
But some people think that it is, that they're giving thanks to God for their blessings. What I said this year was, let us be truly thankful for those blessings which we are about to receive.
All right,
now, I'm thankful. I felt very thankful this Thanksgiving that I had my family around me, that we had wonderful food, that we were happy, that things were going well. For all of the, it was a time for me to express my gratitude for the wonderful things in my life. For me, it was not a religious holiday. But, I mean, yes, anything can be religious if you want it to be. I mean, sex can be religious.
Sex can be religious?
Yes, I mean, there's I read in here.
What? I read in here that a Christian orgasm is better than any other kind. I'm not kidding. I read that in your blog.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
Well, see, we have all points of view.
You have all points of view.
But there's a whole movement now that says sex is a very spiritual act. You know, whatever the sacraments are different to everybody. I mean, a meal, a wonderful meal with wine and candles and great friends around can be a spiritual.
Sally, let me bookend to the show because we haven't come to the end, but we're getting there. And that is, we start off talking about your journalistic career. You're now a blogger. This is the digital age where we're looking at the greatest revolution in journalism ever since the Gutenberg Library. You're a journalist. You're part of this revolution. Do you think this is journalism, what you're doing? You know, there's a big issue as to whether bloggers are journalists, you know, conceptually and in the court, so forth and so on. What do you think?
Well, I think that... Yes, it is. A lot of journalism, as you know, is opinion. I mean, we have the op-ed page and the editorial page, and this falls under the label of opinions. When you go to WashingtonPost.com, you go to the opinion section, and then you hit on faith, so that it would be that part of journalism. But, for instance, I am going to interview Barbara Walters because she has a special on God coming out. I'm going to interview her about her views about God. I did an interview last week with Rabbi Steinsaltz, who is did the definitive translation of the Talmud.
So that's journalism.
So I'm doing interviews, and plus I'm also giving my own opinions. I did a book review. I'll do another one. So yes, I would say it's definitely journalism.
Now we have come to the end.
This is it?
Does a religious blog make a difference? Yes or no, you have about 22 seconds.
Yes, it does, because I believe that it's really important in this day and age, in the world, in our global society, for everyone to have as much understanding and compassion for each other as possible. And if they can understand each other's religions, then we are well on the way.
Sally Quinn, thank you for coming by, Sally.
Thank you, Jamie.
And thank you for coming by. Come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.